Apparently the winning formula is add 5 millimeters and you end up with an overpowered fan. But what if you add 11 millimeters to the rad and 5 millimeters to the fans? Well, that's how you end up with this beast here. Welcome to Machines & More. Today we're going to be checking out this guy here. It's the new Phanteks Glacier ONE T30. It's a lot of numbers, but it's still a very interesting AIO. Recently we saw how potent these new T30 fans are, and if you have the space, they're absolutely a great choice for a cooling application. Phanteks sent by this beefed up new AIO featuring these fans for this review. A big thanks to them. This video isn't sponsored, so all the review opinions and findings are independent. To start, let's take a look at some of the features of the unit. The standout feature here is the thick rad, and it is quite thick for an AIO at 38 millimeters. So for some of you with clearance limited SFF builds, that's gonna be a problem along with these thicker fans. But for a lot of you guys, you're like, I don't get what the big deal is, right? But either way, do be advised, it is on the thick side. Phanteks also makes a Glacier ONE MP, which features the same pump, and that rad is only 27 millimeters. So this one is a good bit thicker than that. Typically for AIOs, you'll see anywhere between 25 and 30-ish millimeters, and this one is right up there with the one on the Arctic Liquid Freezer 2. As you might know, Acoustic makes liquid coolers as an OEM for plenty of brands like Corsair and NZXT, and this one is an Acoustic unit. It's a Gen 7 pump, just like the NZXT X53 over here. The main difference here is this is spec'd with a thicker rad. So other than the branding, the tubing, the design of the stuff over the pump, critically the fans, the guts of this unit are going to be very similar to other Gen 7 Acoustic units on the market. Probably the most important feature with the Glacier T30 is these fans that it's equipped with out of the box, and these are the 30 millimeter thick T30 fans that I reviewed recently. These guys are one of the best 120 millimeter fans on the market right now, and I won't talk about these in length because I'll just link to the review here, but these bad boys are absolutely going to be the distinguishing performance feature for this whole combo here, and because it's an Acoustic unit, the fans are going to be that one area that Phanteks can distinguish itself. With this thick rad, you do want a fan that has good static pressure performance, and these are an excellent choice. So that puts this whole ensemble at 69, almost 70 millimeters if you include the rubber dampeners on the fans. So it is quite a bit, so make sure you have that clearance. One thing I'll note on mounting the fans to the rad is that the unit thoughtfully comes with two different screw lengths for attaching the fans. The longer ones account for attaching through a case, but they come jumbled all together in the same bag and you have to identify them first, so make sure you get the correct ones. That's totally fine to use the shorter ones when you're intending to use the longer ones because you might just not get any thread engagement. But if you use the longer ones when you want to use the shorter ones, then you could damage your heat fins on the rad. Otherwise, installation is pretty simple. You just choose an AMD or an Intel plate that locks into the grooves on the pump. And because of how this system is designed, you have quite a lot of freedom with how the pump head is oriented. It doesn't have to be mounted square to the board, and there's pretty fine gradations. And that's something I really appreciate about Acoustic units. Phanteks has this magnetic cover that sits over the pump to provide some noise dampening and DRGB lighting, and it just slides over the pump block and clicks into place. One thing, this cable does need a lengthier adapter cable to connect up to a 3-pin motherboard header, and I think a lot of folks are gonna be doing that since you might not have a Phanteks RGB controller, and this cable does end up getting pretty long, so be advised. The RGB is subtle, it's addressable, and I don't think it's overly flashy, but you can just turn it off if you don't want it. The head does dampen a little bit of the noise from the pump as well, so I would keep that in place. This pump has a cable running from it that's intended to be connected to an included splitter cable that is also connected to your fans, which are daisy chainable. I'll talk about the pump speed and noise more specifically when we get to the acoustics discussion, and we'll see if that's actually a good idea to have everything follow the same signal. One feature on this pump head I like is the use of 90 degree elbows, and that just makes your tubing run a lot more flexible. If you've seen the Arctic Liquid Freezer, one of the concerns with this unit is that the tubes run straight out of the head, so it's quite hard to wrangle. And at least for installing in a case, the elbows make the extra thickness of the rad something that's a little bit easier to work around because now you don't have to worry about the tubing around it. Is all that volume put to good use? Well, let's take a look at the thermal performance of this unit. I was curious how this would stack up against another performance-driven unit like the Arctic Liquid Freezer 2 and 240 version. And I'm also going to be testing against another Gen 7 ACE Tech unit, the NCXTX53. And all this testing is done in a Cooler Master NR200, set up as a side-mounted intake. And this is a real-world testing configuration in case. Set up with top and bottom case fans. These are the Noctua NFA 12x25s locked at 1000 RPM. For each of the tested noise levels, fan speeds were locked, and while the Liquid Freezer 2's pump is meant to be connected up with the fans to one single header, after 45% PWM, the fan runs at full speed anyway at 2000 RPM. So for both tested speeds, that pump is 100%. For the X53 and the Glacier, the Gen 7 ACE Tech pump is locked to 70%, and both of these follow the same curve, so at this level, it's at 2100 RPM. So for the first tested noise level, I'm targeting a level half a decibel above the noise floor. The T30s run at 1260 RPM here. The NZXT Air P120s run at 1000 RPM, and the P12s on the Liquid Freezer hit 1180. Here's an interesting thing though. I did actually get that Arctic P12 growl with this round of testing, and that did register on the decibel meter, so that's the RPM level that I had to stop at. With the 3700X running at an OC of 4.3 GHz and 1.25 volts, drawing about 95 watts at this level, the Glacier does have quite a commanding lead, and it's about 2 degrees to the good compared to the LF2, and a whopping 4 degrees ahead of the X53 here. Well, it's not a huge surprise though, these T30 fans are that good, right? If we bump up fan speeds a bit, not that this chip necessarily needs those higher fan speeds, but we just want to see the performance is there. At a level of 2.5 decibels above the noise floor, things are much more audible here. The Glacier T30 spins at 1575 RPM. The X53's fans are at 1250 RPM, and the P12s on the LF2 are at full speed, and no growl here. Still the same ordinal position here. The gap between the LF2 and the Glacier 240 is fairly consistent, still around 2 degrees with the CPU, and the Air P120s they're pretty ordinary fans, so they really are holding back the performance of the X53. But clearly, the Glacier 240 is a very good unit performance-wise, and this is the reason I often prefer good 120mm fans over 140s, because good ones can easily smoke 140. For the NR200 testing I did for the Max review, I also tested the same setup with that Cooler Master 280, and let's just throw that data point onto here. At this noise level, the 140s on this unit spent at 1250 RPM. So yeah, the Phanteks unit can absolutely outperform a 280 AIO, in fact, by quite a lot. So what's doing the heavy lifting? Is it the thick rad or is it the fans? Well, easy to test. Let's throw the same fans on the X53 at the same tested RPMs. All right, look at that. With the same fans, the performance in a case at both levels is pretty much indistinguishable. That doesn't mean the thicker rad isn't doing anything, but it does indicate to me that the fans are basically the driving force here, and they usually are for most liquid cooling setups. There's one thing to keep in mind for a real-world setup, and in many cases, the thicker you go overall, the more choked off your airflow is going to get. Case in point, with the NR200, that right-side fan on the rad panel is inching ever closer to the power supply shroud as you go thicker. So while in theory a thicker rad isn't necessarily a bad thing, if the extra thickness results in more limited airflow or a choke point, then it might just cancel out the efficacy there. But the good news is, if you have a decent AIO already, a fan upgrade can totally breathe new life into your unit. All in all, this unit out of the box is going to be the best 240 AIO that you can get right now in terms of thermal performance. All right, so usually I do a round of fan noise samples, but since I've already documented the noise levels on the Phanteks T30s, I'm just going to direct you to that review. These do emit a slightly higher frequency sound quality when compared to something like the Noctua NFA 12s when they get to the higher RPMs. But at the end of the day, they're still very, very well behaved. However, I did want to take a little deep dive into the pump noise, and you would think that with the implementation of an ACE Tech Gen 7 pump, it would perform basically the same as the X53 in terms of pump noise, right? And that wasn't the case here. I noticed a pretty audible clicking noise coming from the review units when the speed was above 50% or 1700 RPM. Plural, because I let Phanteks know that the test unit sounded kind of off, so they asked me to test another one, and unfortunately, I had a pretty similar finding there. Now, typically a hum or a whirring noise is expected with AIO pumps, and that's just the nature of these things. However, I think a clicking sound is abnormal, and it can be pretty irritating to some. Just to be clear, this isn't air bubble noise. This unit is filled pretty well, I'd say like 98%. And I ended up running it for an extended period of time to see if breaking it in would get any better, and it didn't. So here's just a cross comparison between the X53 at the same overall measured decibel level compared to the Glacier 240. Both pumps are locked to 70% or 2100 RPMs, just for the sake of comparison. Now it's important to keep in mind that this is more likely to only manifest itself at the higher end of the fan curves, and if you've got everything hooked up to the same header, this will be where the fans are at 1575 RPM. Take a listen. That clicky noise is definitely audible even above the fan noise, and I'm highlighting it because it would bother me. In my experience, the X53's Gen 7 pump does get a little audible above 65% or so, but it's nowhere near as noticeable as what you've just heard. Perhaps the X53 is a little bit better dampened with its big RGB display, and the little cover on the Glacier 240 doesn't help as much. I don't actually think that's the case though, because I've heard a defective X52, and that was definitely very audible even though it shares a similar shroud design as the X53. Now on the topic of fan speeds and pump speed, it's meant to run off the same header, which means that however you set your fan curve, your pump will also index off that same signal. So if you set it up that way, you probably won't start hearing the pump until your curve passes 50%. But once you head into that higher performance territory, yeah. So regardless of whether this pump is behaving to spec or not, my preference with this type of setup is to hook them up to separate headers, so at least I can have more granular control of the pump on its own. If the pump bothers you, and this varies from person to person, you could always set it to flatline past 50% and set up that way. You only give up a little bit of performance anyway. So for example, at the lower noise level tested, the pump set at 50% versus 70% resulted in a 1.3 degree delta, and that might be totally worth it to you from a sonic perspective. With all that being said, Phanteks is looking into it, and they're thinking it might be a bad batch of pumps from Ace Tech. I hope so, because otherwise this is a really stellar unit, and the expectation here is just that it performs similar to Gen 7 Ace Tech units. And if I get to retest it, I'll be sure to have a follow-up. So acoustic performance aside, this is the best 240 AIO on the market for thermal performance. And to wrap this one up, let's just have a look at the value proposition. If you already have a decent AIO and it's still working well or under warranty and you want a performance uplift, then I see no compelling reason to throw the baby out with the bathwater. Just upgrade your fans to the T30s. And as you've seen, performance is quite close with just a fan upgrade. This unit is going to come in at the high end of pricing for a 240 AIO, and the roughly 170 US market prices, because it includes two of these T30 fans. Now, granted, prices for these fans are all over the place right now. At launch, they were closer to 30, and now they're somewhere around 40, but I'm not going to try to predict how hardware prices land in the future, but suffice to say you're getting a Gen 7 Ace Tech Core for, say, $100, a 5-year warranty, which matches that from Corsair, and it's a year less than NZXT, plus two of these T30s, and let's just call it $70 then, right? And that's where the value breaks down. As of right now, the X53 is going for $120, so if you were to upgrade the fans right away, you'd be well over the cost of the Glacier 240. So if this level of fan is where you want to end up with anyway, then there's a good reason just to spring for the unit right away, assuming you can fit it. You simply can't get a unit out of the box that performs better than the Glacier T30 right now, and this performance is best in class. Now, if the noise issue is just an isolated issue from a bad batch, then I would recommend this unit without any reservations. But if you're buying one right now, I'd say just take the time, check the noise level out just to make sure everything is okay. I hope you found the review and the information helpful. Please give a like if so. Please subscribe also if you haven't already, and product links for the tested items are down below. Thanks for watching today.